Welcome to the quick start tutorial to Dwar7s Spring, a board game of Empire expansions from Vesuvius Media and designed and illustrated by Luis Blue. Dwar7s Spring can be played from 2 to 4 players ages 12 and up in about 1 to 1.5 hours. In Dwar7s Fall, you built your kingdom and gathered resources to prepare. In Dwar7s Winter, you battled the elements and fought monsters to survive. Now it's time to expand your empire across the land, hatch your dragons, and raise your army of heroes to save fairies from savage beasts. It's springtime! To set up a game of Dwar7s Spring, first let's create the world map. Take the wildland petals, shuffle them, take one and place it in the center of the playing area. Then take all of the remaining petals and place them around as shown. Create and shuffle a deck of monster cards and reveal three of them in a row face up. Take each card's monster miniature and place it on the corresponding location. If there's a monster already on it, place it in the nearest wildland petal. Next, take the top six monster cards and shuffle them with all the quest cards to create the expedition deck. Return the rest of the monsters to the box. Take three cards from the top of this new deck and place them face up in a row. Place all resource tokens near the playing area. Give the youngest player the first player token. Now, onto your empire board. Each player gets one empire board and chooses a color. 12 settlements, a fortress, 7 dwarf tokens, and 7 starting hero cards. Look for the ribbons on each card to find the matching color. Shuffle the level 1 dragon deck and give 1 dragon to each player. Place the remaining deck on the table face down. Then place the level 2 and level 3 dragon deck on the table. Shuffle the fairy cards and place them face down on the table. Give each player 1 fairy card. Give each player 4 exhaust tokens to place besides their board to create their treasury. When a player gets resources, they put them in their treasury. Back to your board, place your dwarves on the bastion spots located at the top. There are 4 settlement spots with resources on each of the 3 production lines. Place settlement minis on each of their spaces. Place the fortress on the capital spot. Dragon cards are placed next to the empire board. Now it's time to find a starting placement for each player. Beginning with the first player, each player chooses 1 settlement from the leftmost spot of any of the production lines and place it on the world map. Then, starting with the last player and going counterclockwise, all players place 1 more settlement, always choosing the leftmost spot of any production line. The rules of placing a settlement dictates that you may not place them in an area that is a wildland, on water spots, or on a space that already has a settlement. You can place settlements on greenfield spots or on resource spots, in which you immediately take the resource shown on the spot. Note the amount of resources you collect from resource spots changes depending on the active monster on the world map. For example, when this monster is out, if you place your settlement on this spot, you do not collect 2 food resources, instead you only collect 1. A game of Dwar7s Spring plays in 4 eras or less. First phase is start of a new era, then production, then action, and finally end of era. In start of a new era, all dwarves return to their player's bastion. Then you remove any exhaust tokens from your dragons so they are now ready to be used again. In the production phase, you gain resources, wood, food, or gold. All players check their empire board to see which resources they gain depending on the spots revealed when they build a settlement. In this case, the player will get 1 food and 1 gold token from the supply. Just a note, you may only have up to 7 of each of the 3 resources in your treasury at any one time. Any excess must be discarded. The action phase is where players take their turn. The first player takes their turn by taking a dwarf from their bastion and placing it on a spot, either on the world map or their empire board to perform an action. These actions are: build a settlement, build your fortress, explore, summon a fairy, command dragons, and go on a quest. There are two free actions a player can do at any time on their turn, as many times as they can. Train your dragon and play fairy cards. The action, Build a Settlement, allows the player to take a settlement from their player board and place it on the field spot or in a resource spot on the world map. To do this, the player takes one of their dwarves from the bastion and place it on the empty building spot at the far left of one of the production lines. Then, the player takes the leftmost settlement of that production line and place it in a valid spot. These spots must not be in a wildlands or a river spot. They can be either a grass spot or a resource spot. To build, a settlement must be adjacent to another settlement or a dwarf. If a dwarf is on a wildland spot, then all spots surrounding the wildland petal tile are valid spots. If a player was able to completely build the entire line of settlements of a production line, they earn bonus points. If you have 7 of each of the 3 resources of wood, food, and gold, you can build your fortress. It acts just like a settlement, but it's stronger. It cannot be targeted by fairy cards. It is not affected by negative effects of monsters, which means you can collect normally on resource spots when built. Your dragon's nest capacity is increased by 1 to hold up to 6 dragons. And finally, it allows you to draw 2 cards instead of 1 when fighting a monster or harvesting. When using the Explorer action, a dwarf will be placed on the world map from the bastion. It will allow the player to fight monsters, gather resources, and it's the main way to expand across the board. You can place dwarves adjacent to any of your settlements or your own dwarves in grass, river, and resources spots. If you have a dwarf in a wildland, remember that it's adjacent to any spots surrounding it. You, however, do not gain any resources this way, only when building settlements on these spots. Here's an example of fighting. You place a dwarf on a spot in a wildland petal. It has a monster in it, so you'll be fighting using your hero deck. First, shuffle your deck and then draw cards for each of your dwarves in the petal, plus 1 for each adjacent settlement, and plus 2 if your fortress is next to the petal. You'll be looking for the number of axe icons you have drawn. If it's equal or greater to the number of the corresponding monster's power, it is defeated. Remove the monster's menu from the map and gain the reward listed in the bottom of the 2 fairy cards. Take the monster's card and add it to your deck. This card will act as a filler and does nothing when drawn. Think of it as getting tired because of the fight, and it's worth victory points at the end of the game. Lastly, reveal a new card from the expedition deck. Gather follows a similar trope. When you place a dwarf on the wildland spot that is not occupied by a monster, you can gather resources. First, shuffle and draw from your deck 1 card for each of your dwarves on the petal, 1 for each adjacent settlement, and 2 for your adjacent fortress. This time, you'll be looking for backpacks. For each backpack you draw, you gain that number of resources. As an action, you can use one of your dwarves to draw 1 fairy card. The maximum number of fairy cards you can hold is 5. On your turn, you can use fairy cards as a free action. This is the symbol of fairy power. By default, you have 1 fairy power. You can increase this power to 2 when you place a dwarf on the second dragon spot on your empire board. All fairy cards give you a special benefit. You can get extra resources, move dwarfs across the board, swap opponent's dwarfs or settlements with your own, or add access to defeat monsters. Each card allows you to do the task up to that many times as your fairy power. Another action is Command Your Dragons. For your dragons, there's an ability to the top left of the cards that you'll gain when you activate them. If it gives you resources, then you immediately gain those resources from the supply. If it's successes such as axes and or backpacks, then until the end of the era, you add those successes to fights and gatherings you may perform. Place your dwarf on the first dragon spot, and you can activate up to 2 dragons by placing exhaust tokens on them. Be careful that you do not activate the same dragon twice. Then, on the second spot, you can activate another 2 dragons, plus your fairy power is increased by 1 until the end of the era. As a free action on your turn, you can train your dragons. To do this, spend a number of resources shown on the card to advance to the next level. Switch out these cards found in the next level dragon decks. As their level increase, so does the ability's rewards. You may train any number of dragons on your turn, provided you have enough resources. Exhausted dragons may also be trained, but they still remain exhausted. Remember that your dragon's nest can hold up to 5 dragons and 6 if you have your fortress. To gain more dragons, you need to go on a quest. When you place a dwarf on an expedition spot on your empire board, you can fulfill a quest and add that card to your hero deck. These cards not only build up your deck, but they are more powerful so that they will help you be more successful in fighting and gathering. Place your dwarf on an expedition spot to choose a quest to fulfill. The quest card will have a certain number of conditions you need to meet. So if a card shows 5 food on it, it means you need to have 5 food in order to fulfill it. You don't need to discard those resources. Some cards require a certain dragon level or a number of settlements that you need to have on the world map. If you successfully complete the quest, you may draw a level 1 dragon from the deck and place it in your dragon's nest. After taking the card, reveal the next card of the expedition. If it's a monster card, remember to place the monster mini on the corresponding wildlands and announce its effect. Monsters are nasty creatures and will mess up your game. Here's a quick overview to what to expect when facing them. Most monsters will reduce gathering when building settlements to 1 for a specific resource. This monster will prevent players from going on quests, and this prevents the building of settlements on the nearest resource spots. Once all players have completed their actions and all the dwarves have been used, it is the end of an era. The first player token is passed to the next player to the left, and a new era begins. If at the end of the era there are less than 6 cards in the expedition area, or it's the end of the fourth era, the game ends. Now it's time to count points to see who won. Completed quests, defeated monsters, and dragons all score victory points found at the top right of their cards. Your Empire board awards you victory points for each revealed star when you completely build settlements on each production line and for a constructed fortress. Finally, for every 7 resources you have in your treasury, you gain 1 victory point. The player with the most victory points wins the game. If there's a tie, the player with the most heroes wins. This concludes the quick start tutorial to Dwar7s Spring. For more information about this game and others, please check out VesuviusMedia.com. The Cardboard Stacker likes to thank Vesuvius Media for sponsoring this video. Thanks for joining us again. For more board game videos like this one, including reviews, previews, and how to plays, come check out the Cardboard Stacker channel on YouTube and visit thecardboardstacker.com. This has been Ferdinand, the Cardboard Stacker, reminding you to keep on stacking games.